Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Using NCBI Data with Cloud Providers. For the next 20 minutes or so, I'll talk about using NCBI data, and specifically dbGaP data, with cloud providers. This talk is broken into three parts. First, a cost and bandwidth view of cloud compute for dbGaP. Second, I'll talk about initializing the SRA toolkit for streaming data onto various compute clouds, using the Amazon cloud as a specific example. And then finally, I'll talk about an Amazon machine image specifically designed for using dbGaP data in the Amazon cloud. It's very likely we'll have similar tools for other cloud providers in the near future. So one possible option is that you could make a specific private cloud for your data sets that are also in dbGaP. However, as I will outline over the next 15 minutes or so, another option is to essentially use dbGaP itself as a storage cloud and use a compute cloud such as Amazon Web Services to process the data without doing any storing there. An optimal way to do this may be to stream the data, and I'll have a short explanation of how to do that a bit later. NCBI provides capabilities via the SRA toolkit to make it look like data were local to the cloud. We also have a 100 gigabit connection to Internet 2, such that you can transfer rather fast. Let me give you some examples of how fast. So, for example, a big use case for dbGaP data is to compare a single gene across 10,000 patients or cases. If we were to look at how long that would take, even with a 10 gigabit connection, you'd be looking at just a couple of seconds, assuming you use the SRA toolkit and didn't do something like use Aspera to dump to S3 and then go ahead and realign your FASTQ files. If you do want to realign BAM files, we'll talk about that, a very quick way to do that when we discuss the AMI in the third part of this presentation. If you wanted to reanalyze one very large BAM file, you're probably looking at 4 to 8 minutes for transfer time. And if you wanted to reanalyze 100 very large BAM files, you're probably talking about 7 hours or so. For thousands of large BAM files, it's going to take a little bit longer, but we'd like to reiterate that first, you should only be dumping entire contents of thousands of BAM files if you absolutely have to, and also you can transfer parts of BAM files in parallel using the SRA toolkit. I will show you where the documentation is in just a few minutes. So the next two slides are somewhat supplemental, but there are, I think, important things to think about when one thinks about transferring large and computing on large data sets. Thinking about things like efficiently parallelizing one's code, typically cloud providers will sell you effectively as many servers as you want in one time. So if you can split processing one file into many processes, this may make things much more efficient. Additionally, it is much cheaper instead of storing on an S3 bucket or other storage cloud to use dbGaP as a storage cloud. And I'm happy to discuss that offline with folks, or if you have specific questions that you'd like to ask with everyone else, please go ahead and put them in the question box. But this slide is really supplemental. So understanding your use cases, if you only need one gene or two genes, something like that, or maybe a 5 or 50 megabase region, it's going to be a lot cheaper than transferring the entire genome. So, and typically, depending on the parameters of mapping, the BAM files will contain most of the reads of interest in that region, even if they may not be aligned exactly as you would prefer. Based on these use cases, you can determine transfer time. It's good always to think about your code efficiency and your security requirements. And you should think about various costs before you think about transferring everything up to a storage cloud. so often, it's very redundant. What I'd like to do now is transfer into a more technical part of the presentation, where I show you how to actually initialize the SRA toolkit. This is somewhat technically complex, but really should be done if you want to use the SRA toolkit manually to stream to the cloud. If you don't want to initialize the SRA toolkit yourself, you can launch the AMI we have built on the Amazon cloud, which is pre-configured to deal with dbGaP data, assuming you have the correct NGC file from authorized access. So to get the SRA toolkit, one thing you could do is go to the SRA main page and go to the center of the screen where you see Download SRA Toolkit. Here, you can get the SRA toolkit pre-compiled for a bunch of different architectures, as well as decryption tools for dbGaP data, if you wanted to transfer all of the data and do that directly. You can also get the SRA toolkit, as well as some VDB utilities, on our GitHub site. A really nice thing about that is that if you have issues, you can make pull requests directly to our developers, just like you would do on any other GitHub site. So if we go into the SRA tools repo, we can see a download page, which is displayed over here on the right, that looks just like the download page on the web, and you can also get source code if you wish. To initialize the precompiled binaries, you go through these very standard steps, but at the end then, and you need to go into the bin directory. At the end then, you'd run vdbconfig-i. That would take you to a VT100 screen. And one thing most people don't know is that if you disable local file caching, you will not upload the, or download, depending on the case, the entire SRA file from dbGaP, but only a small part of it. That can be very useful if your use case is similar to the one where you might want to analyze one gene or one gene at a time over 10,000 cases or patients. So then you can initialize the SRA toolkit, establishing default download directories, first for public SRA, and then also for dbGaP. These should be at the same level. It's also important to note that the NGC file should go in your dbGaP default download directory. If you have any questions, please put them in the question pod and I'll answer them at the end. So while this can be extremely useful and save an enormous amount of money, these steps are somewhat technically complex and should probably be implemented by a bioinformatician in the group that has authorized access to dbGaP data. Some of the advantages of this approach is that there are lots of tools in the SRA toolkit. You can dump SAMs, but you can also get pileups automatically. And you can get pileups over a range of SRA accessions from either dbGaP or public SRA. Another very nice thing is if your toolkit is initialized properly, you can use HiSAT2 directly with SRA accessions, GATK directly with SRA accessions, and very soon you will be able to use Bioconductor directly with SRA accessions. That said, many people ask me how they would use BWA directly with SRA accessions, particularly in dbGaP. What I would suggest at this point is an Amazon machine image called NGS Swift. Again, we'll very likely have similar Amazon or similar cloud images for other cloud providers in the near future, but I'd like to use the Amazon machine image as an example right now. First, I would like to make everyone aware that using NGS Swift, you are tacitly acknowledging that you will comply with all the policies and regulations surrounding dbGaP data, all the ones that would be there generally. So I mentioned Bowtie or BWA previously, and BWA is already preloaded on the Swift AMI. Although, as you just saw, you could take the Swift AMI and you could modify it and put different tools on it. But there are also preloaded variant callers, RNA-seq tools, regular utilities, etc., as well as an updated version of the SRA toolkit and our NGS software development kit. There are also a bunch of assembly tools, but if you're interested in assembly tools, please email us at ben.busby@nih.gov or webinars@ncbi.nlm.nih.gov. Anyway, taking and configuring this AMI would be a fairly straightforward way to then be able to use BWA. One would want to then use it and then implement BWA. Someone asked a question, where can they find the AMI? I'm going to show you in two slides. So here, I just wanted to make sure you could all see this. Here are some of the included tools in this particular AMI. So that's a very nice thing, and it makes it very easy to do this type of thing. Additionally, Amazon has decided to include 1,000 genomes as well as genome in a bottle, which many people use to filter variants in their public S3 buckets, and those are all ready to go on this particular AMI. So as well as we have in dbGaP a 1,000 genomes instance, which can be used for testing of dbGaP. Instructions for this are in the docs folder on the GitHub site. Also in the GitHub site, you can find the AMI right here. So going back up to the main, that should be in the under the latest release. You should be able to find the AMI. And it is expected that the AMI, as well as the GitHub site, will be updated, and you can submit questions and pull requests. Someone asked, how often is the AMI updated? And I believe, although I'm not 100% sure, but I believe that the AMI will be updated every time the SRA toolkit is updated. However, if the community has specific requests to be added to the AMI, we may be able to do ad hoc updates of the AMI. So I hope that was informative to you. And in fact, this is my last slide. I'd like to thank the folks that are on the first slide. And now I, as well as Chunlin Zhao, who is the author of the AMI, will be able to take any questions you may have. So I'll field the questions, and then I will defer any that are appropriate over to Chunlin. Currently, we're planning, even if the SRA toolkit is not updated quarterly, we'll update NGS Swift quarterly. And once again, it can be found in the GitHub area NGS-Swift. So NGC files you receive once you receive authorized access to dbGaP. There are a bunch of webinars on how to get authorized access, but basically if you put that into the directory in which you are streaming files into from dbGaP, it will decrypt them automatically. So later questions can either be emailed to webinars@ncbi.nlm.nih.gov, or they can be sent to me, ben.busby@nih.gov. So someone asked how those uploading data, whether they think about how best their data can be analyzed and to be aware of cloud options. I would say it's good for all users to be aware of cloud options. In terms of from a submitter perspective, in my personal opinion, I think the number one biggest thing submitters can do for potential users and themselves is to submit really clean and complete metadata and to use common data elements when they're thinking about submitting their metadata. In my personal opinion, I think the FedEx toolkit is a great way to get started with that. And also NLM has a common data element portal with common data elements from across the NIH, institutes across the NIH. All right, great. I hope this webinar has been informative to you, and I hope you have a fantastic rest of the day.